Welcome, Dr. Sharness.
Thank you. There are two things to know. I was asked to do this, which really talks about the process, and it fits in as a very nice follow-on to the presentation that Professor Lane presented. So it's the same concept of research, but it's looking at it from the opposite side. So you'll see some things that are similar and then some that I'm just going to expand on. And the second is, if you see the tie that I'm wearing up close and personal, you can thank Brett Copeland because he's the one that asked for this particular tie and this particular character, and you can ask him why he picked it, we'll leave it at that. So that's your goal for the rest of the PCC. So I'm currently a full-time employee of and a stockholder in Shire PLC, and for those of you who follow the news, Shire is still an independent company, and we are doing business as usual, developing recombinant collagen 7, and until somebody tells me to stop, I'm working overtime to get it done. So what are we trying to do with this presentation? The first thing that I want you to know is I'm not testing your vision, and I'm not going to read this to you. Okay. So, but really the goal is what's a clinical trial? And so I'm going to ask, since you can't ask me questions, I'm going to ask you questions. Who here has ever participated in a clinical trial? Wow. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So I'm assuming the rest of you haven't, which means that this is good. So I'm going to talk about it and what the roles are and what it means, and go into a little bit more detail. There are a lot of terms that are spoken about, phases, objectives, all sorts of things, and we'll try and deal with that. This will be on the web, and everything that I'm putting out is actually official with government support, and it's and it'll be on the web, and so you can find it. So this should be pretty interesting. So to reinforce Dr. Lane's statement, what is a clinical study? A clinical study is, or research, is a procedure to make a discovery, test a hypothesis, or demonstrate a known fact. It's research. And the difference is, instead of being in a laboratory or a petri dish or an animal, it's in a human. They're called human volunteers. They can also be called subjects, participants, and as you heard earlier, patients implies a specific relationship with a physician, and so some people use it, but at Stanford, you're not supposed to, and that's probably excellent practice. The study plan is called a protocol, which is typically about this big, and it says everything about how you're going to do it and what you're going to try and do it, and there's all kinds of trials. Typically, if a drug is given or a procedure is done, that's called an interventional study. There are specific definitions of this, and they're actually different in the U.S. and Europe. And so if one is conducting a trial around the world, one has to be cognizant of that. There are also observational studies where one is just trying to understand what's going on with a specific disease. And a natural history study might be considered an observational study. Again, depending on the country and how it's done, that may or may not be considered just purely observational. Now, for the people who take part in the study, the participant, you are the most important aspect of the trial, because without people to be in the study, it doesn't happen, and everybody makes an important contribution. One of the things that is unfortunate is that some people believe that if you do a trial to test an intervention and the intervention doesn't have the expected results, that it's a failure. That's not true. When you test a hypothesis, if it's a well-described study, any answer you get is the correct answer. It just happens to be what's true. And research goes forward. As you heard from Dr. Lane, it took them 15 protocol amendments to go forward because they found that they needed to change it to get it right. And so all new information gets incorporated, and it increases the knowledge to the community at large. What do you need to know? Well, you need to know everything to the limits that you can understand, and you need to do it in a way that meets your timeline. And it's not just about a piece of paper that you sign. It's not just about somebody talking to you for half an hour. It means that the process leaves you with the understanding of what you think you need to know to make an informed decision for you or your loved one. Because it's an experiment, standard of care will continue. And there are a bunch of options that things can make it better or worse, and not everyone is going to be treated the same, or maybe they are. It all depends on what the trial is, and that's in the informed consent document. So now I'm going to kind of walk you through about what is a clinical trial and how do you find out about it. So the first is, if you're in the EB family, it's pretty clear that you know what's happening because there are many reasons for it. And I don't need to enumerate them. But there is a legal responsibility in the United States and in Europe that all interventional trials have to be posted in a country-specific way. In the United States, the requirement is it has to be posted at clinicaltrials.gov. This site is listed on the slide. And observational trials are optional. And I've listed the European trials. Depending on who's doing the trials, they may be listed on both, or they may be listed on one, and you have to sort that out. So if you go to clinicaltrials.gov, this is what it looks like. I am not hooked up to the internet. I just printed the screen and managed to figure out how to fit it onto a slide, so it looks pretty. This is what clinicaltrials.gov looks like. Thank you very much. It's always nice to have positive feedback. I spelled epidermolysis bullosa correctly, and when I do that, lo and behold, I get 37 studies. And if you look, and the ranking is something that this program does, and I have no idea where it comes from, but there is a status next to it, and some are stopped, and some are completed, and some are recruiting. And so I just went down to the first recruiting study, and lo and behold, it's our good friend, Dr. Lane's study, listed as the sponsor. And the sponsor has a very specific legal requirement. And if you scroll further down on this web page, I got that out of order. If you want to participate, you have to figure out what the trial is. And you have to understand what the trial is supposed to do, if you fit the trial criteria. And the term for that is eligibility criteria. And within eligibility criteria, there are two components. There's an inclusion criteria, meaning what you have to be in the study. And there's an exclusion criteria, which says if you have other things, you can't be in the study. So it's, and you have to fit everything. And then scrolling down on clinicaltrials.gov, on Dr. Lane's study, here's the eligibility criteria, and they list them. And so there's the eligibility criteria, there are the inclusion criteria, and there are the exclusion criteria. And if you can read all of this, you have a much better visual acuity than I do. But there it is. Now, you can also determine on this website what the trial is about, and that's called an intervention, or if it's an observational study, it'll say what they're trying to do. And in this circumstance, and I'm not going to read this because it's, I could say, is it pronounced lease? Is that right? Lease. Okay. So excellent choice, by the way, because no one else could say that either. And it has all the other information on it. And this is pretty much a model of what all the websites look like. They have all the elements. So you have EB, you found out about a study, you understand what you can have and not have to be in it. What do you do next? Well, you decide, do I want to be in it? You look at the intervention and ask, do I want to try it? And then after you say, do I want to try it, you have to ask some other questions. Am I able, or the person I'm representing, able to participate in the trial? Can I make the commitments that you heard about? And there are two critical issues here. The first is, whatever the answer is, it's the right answer. Not all circumstances are the same. Taking part in research is enormously stressful in terms of time and commitment. But more important, if you ask the question, well, what do I have to lose? I heard that I can withdraw consent at any time. The answer is, you actually have nothing to lose, but the community has an enormous amount to lose, because all trials are designed to understand how many people and participants will be in the trial, and if someone drops out and you can't follow up, that information is lost, and it's maybe difficult to reach conclusions about the trial. So it's very important to understand this is a big deal. It's a commitment, not just to you, but to the entire community. So you've gotten to the point where you said, I can make the commitment, I understand what I'm doing, I want to go further. What do I do? Well, just scroll further down and it says contacts and locations. And in this circumstance, there's actually a person and a phone number and an email, and that's really terrific. Now, in some trials, depending on the sponsor, it will give some generic answers, such as clinical trials office of XYZ Pharma, or something like that. And the doctor may know that. There's usually ways to do it, but this is very clear. And again, a model of how you do it. There's the contact person. And then there's this issue of sponsorship. So what exactly does that mean? Well, the legal answer is, it's the person who pays for it, or entity that pays for it. And it can be anybody. So if any of you want to pay for a clinical trial, be my guest. And there are a lot of people that, and entities that do it, and I've listed some of them here. There's a lot of work, there's paperwork, but it's not restricted, and that's important to know. Anybody can do this. It's all about passion and know-how and funds. But there are responsibilities for this, and I've listed pharmaceutical companies, but this is true for all sponsors. The sponsor has to exert control over everything in the study. And if one is conducting a multi-site trial where there are multiple academic sites, everybody has a stake, but only one person is the boss, and that boss is the sponsor. And that's really important, because it's, you would expect, getting people together in a room, that there will be reasonable people can disagree, but there can only be one answer at the end of the day, and that's the sponsor's responsibility. Now, from a participant's perspective, what you see is the principal investigator. That would be typically a physician at a site, and they conduct and lead the research at one site, and they are responsible for everything that happens there. That's called the conduct of research. And I took this language from the clinical trials website: may consult with sponsor on study planning and design, data analysis and publication. I would say in the rare disease space, if you don't consult with the principal investigator, you're asking for trouble. There is expertise that everybody needs to collaborate with. And there's usually a team, and the team is large. There's a nurse, there's a data manager, there's a study coordinator. There, depending on reimbursement, there may be someone else who does that. And it's all outlined in the study protocol. And then you get to this overall structure. And I actually, this is a very complicated slide, and I didn't make it. I just cribbed it from a government publication. And it's a general structure of pharmaceutical development called out in the critical path report view, and it lists what you do when you go from basic research all the way to clinical trial experience and filing an approval for a drug. And there are a number of terms that are in here. I won't bore you with them, but the critical element is that a clinical outcome means something in a human that addresses the range of all experience of a human with an intervention. So that's really the take-home message. And it's listed here in blue. Well, I guess that's purplish, whatever that is. Okay, so you've heard the term phase. And one of the reviewers within Shire told me that I had to spell phase out because patients may not know what PH stands for as phase. So I spelled it out, and I'm assuming you all know that. And it's not the pH of your swimming pool, which would be little p, capital H, because that means something else. So these shapes are called chevrons, and the major purpose of each phase is listed. So in phase one, this is the first time a drug ever goes in human, the major reason you do it is to understand, is the drug going into a human safe and tolerable? That's the primary purpose. In a phase two, safety is still an issue, but then you have other things that have equal weight, and I'll explain what PK and PD means later. And you want to get some idea about what the dose is and whether it works or not. That's dose finding and efficacy. And then by the time you get to phase three, you've got some idea about safety, so you're continuing to collect data, but it's in the long term. You still need to know some things about the PK and PD, but largely you're trying to confirm that the drug works, that's efficacy, and that it's clinically meaningful, and that's, you know, reasonable. And then phase four, and it would really be a good problem to have if we were discussing a phase four clinical trial in any form of EB, that's when the sponsor has to address all the commitments they made at the time of licensure. And so I would say we all look forward to that date, whenever that may be. So this is a document that kind of blows up the myth that there are discrete phases, and I really want to highlight this. Phases are concepts, and they have names, and I've liberated this document, this drawing from the ICH, which is International Conference on Harmonization, E8, General Considerations for Clinical Trials. And what it really shows is that phases have a lot of uses and a lot of things occur at different phases. And you can spend as much time as you want reading this document. But the major feature is right there is that every trial has a specific set of content. It has objectives, design, conduct analysis, and a report. And that's really the critical element. As different as every study is, they're all the same. They all have the same requirements, and you have to do it in a standardized way because there's an expectation of seeing the report, and there's also an expectation that that report will be published in a peer-reviewed journal. You heard about that from Dr. Lane. So here are the elements of a clinical study. And there are a lot, and the people that do this are very busy trying to get all this done. But more importantly, this slide is intended to show you why it takes longer than you think it ought to. You have to plan for it. You have to contract and startup activities, which means that the people that review contracts, typically lawyers, have to decide that they agree with that, and that's usually not so quick. You have to submit your documents to authorities. In the U.S., it's FDA, but every country has its own agency that does that. And then you have to get local permission to do it. As you heard, in the United States, it's called an institutional review board. In the EU, it's called an ethics committee. In Canada, it's called a REB, which is review and ethics board. And there's all sorts of variations on a theme. And then you have to find people who want to be in the trial, you have to do it. And then here's where things get interesting. After you do your trial, you still have to follow up at the end of the trial to figure out what the safety issues are. And then all this data goes into a digital warehouse and you clean it. You have to make sure that every space where something is supposed to be there is filled and that it's correct. And then you have to close it or lock it so it can't be altered, so then it can be analyzed, so that everybody who analyzes it knows they're analyzing the same set of data. And then you produce a final report, and the abbreviation is called a clinical study report, or CSR. And then you may or may not be allowed to continue receiving the drug afterwards, and that could be an extension study. Some people ask, how big is a trial? And the correct answer is, it's as big as it needs to be. In the phase one, for historical reasons, it, it appears that between 6 and 8 normal healthy volunteers in each drug dose group are adequate, and depending upon the circumstances, there may be between 3 and 6 dose groups. Sometimes there are even more, but this is all done in animals. In phase 2, where you typically dose in patients, it's usually bigger, and it depends on what you're trying to do and how much you know. And in phase 3, where you have to prove it, that's where sophisticated statistical calculation called a power calculation is used to estimate how big the trial is going to be to show that it works. Now, largely these are educated guesses, and they balance risk, potential benefit, and availability, and in orphan diseases, it's more complicated because there are limited experts who could even conduct the trials. What you're trying to do, the phase and the objectives of the trial, can also influence how it's designed and how long it's going to be. And other than to say it's complicated, you should know that the informed consent document will spell this out in exquisite detail, and these are critical elements. How people reach that should be discussed with the principal investigator, because they should know. They get a document called an investigator brochure where all of these reasons are explained to them so that participants are fully informed. And sometimes the regulators have their own reasons. They see everything, but they can't always share. And they can sometimes, they always have final say on whether they'll approve it. So that's just how it happens. And then it takes time. The design, this isn't easy. To create all the document takes months, anywhere from 3 to 9 months. Typically, it takes 3 months to start up activities, and then the submissions and getting things through the IRBs takes months, plural. And then there's recruitment and everything else. What is pretty standard is that it takes about a month for database lock, and it takes about 3 months at a minimum to get a clinical study report completed. It can take longer depending on the trial and resources, but expecting it any earlier than 3 months is pushing it. And so phase 1, human pharmacology, when are they done? First time you put a drug into humans. And you can do it any time after. There may be other questions that arise, and you can do a phase 1 study in the middle of a pivotal trial in a different set of people. It depends what question you're asking. Typically, they're done in healthy volunteers, but they may go into patients first. And in rare disease, it's actually quite common that they go into patients first rather than healthy volunteers, and there are a variety of reasons for that. And there are objectives, and we already talked about them. Safety is the primary objective. Pharmacokinetics, that is, what does the body do to the drug that's put into the body? How long does it last? Where does it go? A few things like that. And then you also want to know what the drug does to the body. That's called pharmacodynamics. And so there's this yin and yang of a drug and a body get together, and they each influence each other, and you need to figure that out. And depending upon what the drug is, there are additional things that one needs to know. And there are some study examples. I pulled this out of the ICH document, by the way, so you don't need to memorize this. And I could be wrong. I don't believe that there's a quiz. Phase 2 were done after phase 1 studies. And that's always true. You can't go further. Phase 3 are done after the phase 2 studies, and here are the objectives. And phase 4 studies are understanding how they're done in the real world. And these are some theoretical experiences. And then the post-marketing experience are technically not trials, but they're mandated. And before I go, one final word. The FDA wants to know whether drugs cause things that hurt people. And this program is open to everybody who takes a drug in the US. And here's the website. It's called MedWatch. But critically, if you're taking an investigational drug, you don't use it. There's a separate path for that, and that's the principal investigator's responsibility and the sponsor. And you can do that. So the take-home message is this is complicated. thank you for your participation, and I look forward to getting your written questions.